At this point, I think it's good to just pause for a minute and consider the equations that we've developed. We've developed a few equations through the last few lectures that describe the motion of an aircraft. And so I've just put these on the screen here as kind of a summary. And I'd like to just talk about what these equations represent and make sure that we're comfortable with them and we understand the components of them, because we're going to be working with these quite a bit through the next few lectures. So at the top, we've got our aerodynamic information. Okay, so these top equations here are simply how do we represent the velocity of the aircraft relative to the air around it. There's two different ways we can do that. We can do it through U, V, and W. Those are the three velocity components, U along the x-axis, V along the y-axis, and W along the z-axis. Or we can express this velocity in terms of a total velocity and two angles, either alpha and then one of either of these definitions of beta, okay? And remember, we talked about there's a few these two different definitions and two different nomenclatures that you should be aware of. Usually when people use beta, this is what they mean here. Phillips uses, he says beta experimental. And then usually this beta over here is called the flank angle, and he uses the term analytic beta. So because it's basically a direct analog to alpha, right? So those two are very similar. So anyway, these are aerodynamic angles, and from that we can get the velocity of the aircraft. Anyway, either U, V, or W, or V, alpha, beta, capital V, alpha, beta, I should say. Either of those gives us the information we need to figure out how the aircraft is moving relative to the air around it, okay? Okay, so then these two equations here, this is Newton's second law. So this is basically F equals ma in vector form, and the top one is translational, and then this lower one is rotational. So you can kind of see this in the top one. Maybe it's a little bit easier to see. F equals ma. Basically, what we've done is we've left the acceleration over here. We put all of the forces on the right-hand side and divided through by mass, weight over gravity, right? That's mass. So we divided that through over the right-hand side and left the acceleration in these three components. These are translational accelerations along each of our axes, x, y, and z. And of course, that acceleration is a change in velocity. So this is a change in velocity with respect to time. We can look at these different components here on the right-hand side. So this first term on the right-hand side is the aerodynamic, or what we're calling the pseudo-aerodynamic force on the aircraft here. And that's a function of the pressure and the shear stress along the aerodynamic forces on the aircraft, and also includes the thrust, okay? And that's a function of our angle of attack, our side slip angle, our total velocity, or these three, like we just discussed, could be put in terms of U, V, and W. It's also a function of pilot input. So delta E for the elevator control, delta R rudder, delta A aileron. Could have flaps on it. So like delta F, we could call that, or the throttle setting tau. Anyway, so it's a function of pilot input, as well as these external forces on the aircraft due to our aerodynamic angles. So that all goes into this this vector right here. And we're going to have an aerodynamic model where we're able to predict these aerodynamic forces based off of these inputs here. Okay, we'll eventually be plugging that in there. At least for the in-flight simulation, we'll be doing that. So now this next term, you may not recognize, this term is actually our gravity vector. So what we actually did was took our gravity vector from a previous lesson. In fact, I can just scroll back up here. So this is our gravity vector relative to the aircraft. Remember, as we change our orientation, see that it's a function of theta and psi. As we change our orientation, that determines the force in the x, y, and z coordinate system of the aircraft due to gravity. Okay, so that's what this is here. We've divided off the W here. It was weight times these coefficients, and we actually divided through by mass, remember? So we multiplied by G divided by W, so that's why there's no W here. So this is now a force, though, in the direction of gravity, okay, relative to our the aircraft coordinate system. And then finally, over here on the right-hand side, we have, these are Coriolis forces, as we discussed before. So these are kind of a fictitional force because we have an accelerating reference frame relative to our inertial reference frame. So anyway, those forces show up. Okay, so let me just label this here. This is our weight vector. Due to gravity. Okay, so there we go. That's those are our forces on the right-hand side. And then, and that's actually force divided by mass on the right-hand side. And so what's left on the left-hand side is the acceleration, u dot, v dot, w dot, our change in velocity along each of our axes. Okay, we could walk through a similar analysis here for PQR, and I won't do that, but basically, I'll just point out a couple things here. So this is our change in our rotation rates of the aircraft. So these are accelerations about the three axes of the aircraft, our roll, pitch, and yaw axes. And originally, our inertia tensor was on the left-hand side here, just the same way that mass was being multiplied by acceleration to be equal to the forces. Well, in this case, it's the inertia tensor that we've brought over to the right-hand side then, and because it's a tensor, we're taking the inverse of that and multiplying it by these three equations over here. Now, one thing I want to point out is that we have assumed in our development that the aircraft is symmetric about the XZ plane, okay? So that's pretty true for most aircraft. They're very nearly symmetric about the XZ plane, so meaning that the right and the left-hand sides of the aircraft are basically symmetric. And so because of that assumption, that's why we have zeros right here. And we've also dropped a couple of terms over on the right-hand side due to that symmetry, okay? Now, there's one other thing that we're neglecting that we really haven't talked about, but that is a gyroscopic effects. Oops. Let me fix that real quick. So gyroscopic effects. Okay, so if you have gyroscopes on board the aircraft or some kind of a gyro, that will affect the motion of the aircraft as well when you have accelerations and, you know, that relative to that gyro. So it turns out that most aircraft have some kinds of gyros on board. Actually, most of them due to the propulsion. So you can think of a propeller that has some gyroscopic effect on the aircraft. Same with the jet engine, because you have parts that are spinning at high speeds. And so those types of things we're actually going to account for later. We'll rework these equations later and include, we'll actually relax them so that we don't say that the aircraft has to be symmetric, and we're going to include the gyroscopic effects. But for the purposes of this, or the next few lectures here, we're going to be assuming symmetry, and so we've developed the equations this way, and we've neglected the gyroscopic effects so we can simplify the equations in certain ways. Okay, finally, these last six equations here are what are called kinematic transformation equations. Okay, these simply tell us if we have something in one coordinate system, which is, for example, UV and W, if we know our velocity of the aircraft, the local velocity relative to the wind, then we can figure out the velocity on the ground by using this transformation that depends on our Euler angles. And also, remember, adding the velocity of the wind, the local wind vector, and then that would give us our velocity on the ground relative to the Earth fixed coordinate system, where X points north and Y points east. Also, if we know our orientation, And our rotation rates, our current orientation based off of our three Euler angles, and then our rotation rates, we can actually predict what our change in our Euler angles are going to be, okay? So anyway, these last two equations, or last six equations really, are these kinematic transformation equations. So what we have here is a set right here, these lower 12 equations. These are equations that are all differential equations, meaning that on the left-hand side, we've got a change in an aircraft property. And on the right-hand side, we have known aircraft properties at some point in time, okay? And so basically what we do in a general sense is we can, if we know the state of the aircraft, you know, we know our current alpha, beta, V, or UVW, you know, these are all related up here. We know the current settings from the pilot. We know our current Euler angles that show up throughout here. We know our current, this has UV and W and PQR, our current rates of the aircraft. Then if we know the current state of the aircraft, then we can predict the change in all of these states of the aircraft, okay? So our change in UVW, PQR, our location on the Earth, and our change in Euler angles. And so all we have to do at this point, flight simulation is basically just integrating these equations forward in time. If we know everything on the right at one point in time, then we can figure out what the change in all those properties is. And then we just integrate these equations forward in time. We're going to be doing a slightly different analysis in the coming lectures here to look at what we can learn by linearizing these equations. This, first of all, this is a very nonlinear system of equations. You see things that are multiplied together all over the place. You know, QR, PQ, R squared, P squared, a lot of nonlinearity here. And so we're going to look at what we can learn by linearizing these equations. And we're going to find that we can actually predict some of the dynamics of the aircraft based off of these linear solutions that actually turn out to be really quite accurate, even when we compare them to the nonlinear, more accurate solutions. The linear solutions aren't too bad because usually we're looking at aerodynamics of an aircraft with only small deviations relative to a trim point. Okay, we're usually looking at only small changes in angle of attack and beta, even in forward velocity. So if we just assume that we're really close to a trim point and just look at the small deviations, then the linearized solutions to these actually give us really good solutions. Okay, so this is the summary of our 6 degrees of freedom equations of motion. I hope you feel comfortable with these because we're going to be seeing these equations over and over in the coming lectures. And I want to make sure that you're comfortable with where they came from and what they mean so you can now understand better how to apply them.